हेलो
ऐसा दिस मोहम्मद रासिक या फाइन
मोहम्मद रासिक, हाउ आर यू मैन?
सर, फाइन ग्रेट सर।
टेल मी, यू हैव अ क्वेश्चन?
यस्टरडे आई वाज आस्किंग नो सर रिगार्डिंग दैट व्हेन द इंटरव्यूअर फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन टेल मी अबाउट योरसेल्फ थिंग।
राइट,
ओके सो हाउ टू बिगिन विद यू टोल्ड यू टेल मी
we will talk about it. I have kept all the questions and everything that we will talk. I mean you can ask me questions that you have already done, so the key things are there. Like today we will anyway learn on interviewer game plan. How do you manage that hour or 40 minutes or half an hour of time in front of the interviewer? How do you do it is what we learn today. Tomorrow we will discuss on all questions. So in the end of the session, I thought I will inform people that tomorrow session I don't want to keep any PPT or anything, but I want you all to come with questions. And when you all will come with questions, I will discuss each of it and then say how do you think about it and how do you answer it. So I promise you tomorrow first question we will take is yours.
Tell me
something about yourself, because I think that's the most common and favorite question.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir. Sure.
Right. Anybody has any questions? How many of you have attempted a success story? If yes, let me know. Anybody? Sorry, I'm having my tea. I just got it. It was a little late for me. Yes, anybody? Nobody wants to talk? Okay, let me. If you want to talk, I will pick people. Maybe, Rasik, we just spoke. What do you think? Have you started on the success stories?
Sir, I've started, but I need to complete. I need a day's time. So by tomorrow, most probably, I'll share it.
Right. So see, it's important that you work on it. Otherwise, it's a good half an hour or 1 hour of time pass which we are doing every day. So put effort. Right.
Yeah,
this
sure.
is the only time when you will put effort. Write stories. Write at least 5-6 stories. You will understand more detail today, like how to use those stories and all. If anybody of you have written some stories or thought of some stories, written in the sense I am not asking a paper and pen, but then it would have been easier for us to discuss now. What about others? Arvind. People whose name starts with A. No, I always feel bad. They'll be the first one in the list, and then we'll catch them first.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Arvind. Can you switch on your camera? I would like to see you.
Can you see my audio, sir?
I can't see your image. I can listen to a background music that's playing. Yes, now I can hear you. I can see you. Tell me, Arvind, have you written a story?
Actually, I have two stories, sir. I'm thinking of another four stories, sir.
Wonderful. You started writing it, right? In your story, you are the hero, no?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Very good. Very good.
I'm the hero, sir.
You are the hero. You should always be the hero in your story. And we will learn a little more today of how to use these stories and how powerful these stories can be if it is written in a very right way. See, every time when I say written, I'm not intending that you should have it on a pen and paper. If it is there, it is good. But more like your story should be so much in you. When you talk about it, it should feel like that it's your own, not like picking from something. Very good. Balu, what about you? Have you written something? Hello, Balu, are you there? No, I think Balu is somewhere. Jeremiah, what about you? Should I understand it like people have not written story, they don't want to talk to me? Are you people not in talking terms with me? It's okay to say I haven't written yet. I will write. I want to at least ensure that you people are listening to me.
Sorry, sir. I'm Jeremiah.
Yeah, Jeremiah, tell me.
So, I just don't have any specific story right now, but I can make it by tomorrow.
Have you thought about you, about yourself? Have you thought about in this line or not yet started thinking?
I have thought about this, and before also I have some stories, but okay. I want to relook it and do a new way of story that you are expecting.
Right. See, like the way Arvind said some time back, write as many stories as possible. And then when you talk about your stories, you will understand which story really creates that impact. It's not like you go to an interview and tell all stories to them, but then you need to at least use, you know, three different stories is very powerful. There should be story that explains about you as a person. There should be a story that explains how you are connected to the company. Stories can be a little bit here and there, you know, you tweak it, but then that should help you to get what you want. Very good. What about others? Fayaz?
Sorry, sir, I have to start. I didn't start
it. You haven't thought about it also?
Yeah.
Okay. I think everybody is more or less in those lines. So if I throw you this question, okay, everybody try to... listen this carefully and, you know, try to introspect a little bit, think about it. What is that one thing that you are really proud about yourself in your life? Right? What is that one thing that you are really proud about in your life? If you feel that, oh, I have never thought in those lines, maybe you should start thinking in those lines. The best way is, say, go and ask your parents, ask your mom. Moms are very good in that. Tell that what is that one thing you're really proud about. She will tell you two lines, right? Or two words or two somethings. Then you will understand, are from where does this coming? Or ask her, why do you say this to me? She will only tell you the story, right? She will only give you the, the concept of the story, the first thing of the story. Then maybe go to your very good friend, ask them, what do you think? I'm good at, or what do you think I should be proud at? See, these are the people who live with you. These are the people who knows personally about you. The success of all this is you being your own self and write your own story rather than anything. And these are the people who will help you. Once somebody gives you a little hint, then you will understand. You would just start getting into and mastering in how to do that. Fair enough. Should we start or should we wait a little more? What do you people say? I have only 10 participants I can see in the screen. Shall we start today's thing?
Sir, we can begin, sir.
We can begin, right? We don't, latecomers maybe. I'm sure Shweta would have put an message in WhatsApp already a couple of times. Yeah, I can see that. Okay, fair enough. Because once I start my presentation screen, I can't see the people who are there in my screen. So that's why I was just looking at people to come in and then we'd start. Fair enough. Let me share my screen a little.
Excuse me, sir.
Yep, who's this?
Jamia here.
Yeah, Jamia, tell me.
So I think once my friend told me that you're good at guiding how to go, where to go, and how you need to plan. So how can I bring a story on this?
Come back again. Say what is that you said? You're good at?
Good at guiding the directions, like where you need to go. Like if I want to go from one place to one place. So what is the right way? Like what is the shortest way to go. So that things I can give him as a suggestion. So
are you saying this is with regard to directions on the road to travel or directions?
Yeah. Once my friend told it.
Directions on the road, is it?
Yeah.
And then you want to try to pick a story about this.
Yeah.
Right. See, for me, the top of my mind when I think like that, say any roles which requires meeting people, okay. Right? For example, roles where customer interaction at customer place or at the customer site, reaching places on time, and saving your time and your customer time and things like that. Those are all the top of the things. First, kind of where the stories can go. Right? You need to really write a story about it, saying that how you managed to save somebody's time, reaching on place, which ensured that I spend this. Or you can talk about how geography of a place is interesting thing. Like you put me in a new place which I do not know, I would spend a little time and I get familiar with that. For example, we were actually interviewing candidates for our company, where I was working, called the Urban Ladder. Urban Ladder, there are a lot of delivery associates, service associates, what we call. Now, their job is they have a team of 5 people whom they carry and go to customer's house and install the products. So carpenters will install, helpers will do it. These associates are kind of relation builders. They talk to customers on how did they like the product. They also ask about what other products would you want, and they try to do a little consultative selling over there. So when we're hiring those people, right, we were looking at somebody who can understand the geography of people of the area very easily, because a lot of time is spent on the road traveling to here and there. For example, a story like this, if you have told me there, that's it. I would have been so happy to pick, because this is connecting to there. Now from this story, you need to say which role are you going and how would it connect to. Maybe what I said, like Urban Ladder, if you come as is, the direction understanding is easier. Little bit more, you could put on your core competencies as understanding minute details. Okay. Now, when you put a topic like understanding minute details, it's a question. This is how the question mark in the resume is done. The second question, what the interviewer going to ask you is, what do you mean by understanding minute details? How do you do? Then you connect it to, sir, my observation, and I spend a pretty good time. I'm pretty good at observing things and pretty good at understanding very small, minute details. Like, for example, once it so happened where we are all like stuck in some place, we want to reach something and we need to reach there at a particular time. People had their own confusions. There is some breakages. But once I travel in a particular direction, I understand the geography of that much easily. You can carry on the way you have written the story.
Okay.
Right. My point is, you need to pick your story and connect to that one thing which they are looking at it. And this entire thing will work well if you have done the first part. Remember when in the first session I told you, while resume writing, companies will call you and say that, where to send your updated resume. Then you'll ask them, give me your JD. And you need to study the JD very well, prepare very well, research very well. See what is it that they're expecting, what are the core competencies they're looking at it, and your story should be aligned to those core competencies. Because they are looking at that core competencies, they will also try to ask you in the interview questions which can come with that. And now you have prepared your story with that, so obviously you'll get a chance to talk about your story.
Okay.
Right? Clear?
Yes, sir.
Wonderful. Right. I cannot see now how many people and all. Let's start with today's thing. Okay. Interview, a game plan. Right. Now, a simple question I have put. What is an interview? We all understand the basic answer for that, right? You need to get a job, you will go there, they need a candidate and they will question you. They will try to see if you are correctly fitting in the role or not. And that's actually the interview. Now let's understand this interview thing in a little different way. Okay. I told you this line as well in the beginning. You know more about interviews, not when you attend many interviews, but when you take many interviews. When you take interviews, you will start thinking like an interviewer, and then you will understand how do you ask questions, what do you ask questions, what do you look at in people. See, whatever you look in people as an interviewer, you need to just display that, exhibit that in the interview. That's basically how it is. Now, for a little different way to look at it, imagine you want to buy a mobile phone. Okay, as simple as that. Now you want to buy a mobile phone. You have thought that, say 25,000 rupees you want to spend on the mobile phone that you want to buy, but you don't know which phone to buy and what to do. Now start thinking about how do you start your entire thing? How do you start your entire process of buying a mobile phone where you thought that my phone should have, say, ABCD features and I can spend up to 25,000 rupees to buy a phone. It should have a very good camera. It should have a good network. Memory should be a lot and RAM should be a lot. And maybe what other, you know, look it should be there, or, you know, you thought of a brand, it should be there, whatever. Certain things you already have in mind and you have a budget in hand. Now you want to buy a mobile phone. Tell me, how do you think your process will start? What do you think you will do first? Anybody who can talk to me?
I will first, after finalizing the budget, I will concentrate on the main requirement or the feature which requires, like, properly we are concentrating on the camera, or do we want the battery backup, or do we want look wise or anything.
Very good. You have done that. Now you have a list of features that you want. You have budget. Now what you will do?
Now we go to the showroom and we will ask the best brand in that comparison range.
Okay.
Yeah, we will compare 2 to 3 phones. Suppose we're buying Vivo, Oppo or something else. We will compare in the same range. Suppose my budget is 15,000. I will check the phones, best phones in that. If all the features are offered by Vivo, then I will go by Vivo.
Okay. Okay, very good. So you would see the features which is available there. Now tell me something. If you have kept a budget of 25,000, but if all the features and everything required, if you are getting a phone at 15,000, will you buy it or not?
Yes, I will buy it.
Will everybody buy it, or somebody who in this training feels that no, I thought I'll spend 25. Why will I buy?
Or else we need to wait for a better one or a better range phone in 25,000.
Or whatever you have, you required, you have put a list, it's already there. Then technically you would buy. Or you would say, no, I need only, say, for example, a Samsung phone. I don't want to go for a Chinese phone. You know, a new thought, for example, suddenly came. You know, a lot of border issues happening in India and China. You thought, okay, I will not buy Chinese phone.
Okay, sir.
You got it?
Yeah, now, I got it, sir.
Try to connect it with the way interviews happen. Okay? Now, listen to this carefully. Initially, when you say the budget 25 is the first thing you set, is what the company is setting their budget for paying salary per candidate that they're going to hire. That's the number one. Second one, what you have tried to do, you have listed down all the features that you want. Now they have listed down all the features, in the sense they have listed down what work needs to be done. For that, what is it required? Isn't it? That's what you do. You want to photos to be clicked, so you want a good camera.
Yes.
You want a lot of things to save, so you want good memory. You want a good network, you know, like that. They would also set up, and that is what you call it as JD, right? Your job description, the document which the company has prepared. Now the third step goes the real interview, when you go to the shop. Right now, when you go to the shop, you found that all the features which are there are there at a 15K, you would most probably buy it because you want to save some money. If at all you can save some money from this, same thing with the employer also. If you can save some money, they will save. Maybe imagine you got a phone which all your features, but two features which you want are not there.
Yes, sir.
Then you will think about it. Then you will find two features are there, but the budget is not 25, but it is 28.
Yes.
Then you will think about it. Can I stretch that much money? So you'll compare with those two features and the stretch of money. And should I, you understand how you are buying a mobile?
Yeah. If those two features are the main features, then I would definitely stretch it to 28. If it is not that enough, I would go with a lesser budget phone.
Wonderful. Now those two features are main or important or not important. How would you know? Do you understand that if you go to a shop and that sales fellow has not spoke to you very nicely, would you buy from that shop?
No, sir, definitely not.
Or so that fellow didn't smile at you, or he was like, showed little attitude. He was not so interested in you. You would not buy, right? See, somebody who's very interested and he's pushing, he's trying to understand. Acha, what else? Okay, this is what. Then he tries to explain here and there. Your chances of buying from him is more?
Yes, because that's, I'm more convinced.
More convinced that sales staff in the shop is a candidate who is in the interview. Imagine like that.
Yes, sir.
Now, if you put these three things in place, if you really want to sell, if you really want to get a job, what do you think the sales staff will do?
He,
anything and everything he will do to ensure he will convince you. He don't want you to leave from that job, right?
Yes, sir.
At the same time, if the sales staff is extremely pushing at you, sir, lelo, sir, take it, sir, very good. You will also run away from there, right?
Yeah, he'll sound more desperate.
More desperate. The same thing happens in your interview also. You need to do everything to ensure you convince him to buy that. But at the same time, if you overdo it, then the person says he's unnecessarily desperate. I'm doubtful on the product only now.
Yes, correct.
Are you understanding?
Yes, sir.
Right. Imagine if when I say big brands, it depends on which colleges you have come. Say you are from an IIM and an IIT and, you know, stuff. They have a different brand. It plays an important role. We are from a different college, plays a different role. Somebody from a very different college plays a different role. Imagine these are all brands. Right. How you position your brand is important. Say, for example, you say, do you know that, you know, there are 25,000 Vivo phones we sold in last 5 days. How does suddenly it sounds? Yes, you're getting my point. See, yes, this is how people try to put in different ways. For example, you say that, okay, I needed some discount and stuff like that. Maybe that Vivo fellow or, you know, some phone, he will give you 1,500, you know, rupees discount. Imagine you're trying to go for an Apple. He'll say, boss, this is the price.
Yes.
You got it. Everybody is like that. Now you need to find out what is your spot. Don't, yes, if for example, if you are an Apple, don't try to be a Vivo. Or if you are a Vivo, don't try to be an Apple. You understand what you are and position you in front of your interviewer in such a way that he or she understands how important this job is for you and how potential candidate you have. How do they do that? They need to find all the required features in you. And yes, they need to also find that you are in the budget that they have thought of. If you are really very good and they see that those two features also this person has, I might need to extend the budget. Every company is ready to extend the budget. But yes, only if they get that.
Yes.
Right. Yes, have you all people understood the analogy which I was trying to make? If you have understood, say yes in the chat box. Arvind understood. Yes, Faiz understood. Sharad, Jeremy understood. Very good. Very good. Guys, think about this a little bit, right? When even after the session, this is that simple only. You think yourself like that sales staff who has a target to sell that particular day and how the customer comes. How do you understand their features? By asking little questions and all, the same way you need to do it with your interview. You need to understand the budget. Do you think customers will directly walk into the store and say that my budget is 25? Very less people do. Some companies will also do in the jobs. Like our, for our role, we can pay, you know, 8.5 lakhs as our package and then they will start. Then there is no more discussion over there. But you need to see like that sales staff over there. How do I position? Apart from that, I'm sure when I say an interview, you all understand the general definition. I thought I will give you a context to understand and put yourself in a position. The key thing which I want you all to take it out from this is, if you are an Apple, don't try to be a Vivo. And if you are a Vivo, don't try to be an Apple. First understand what you are. That is only sales. A Vivo can never sell its phone, you know, putting a cover of an Apple and saying that, you know, people will take it in their hand, go back home, they will understand this is not Apple. Same the other side as well, right? I'm not trying to put anybody down or take anybody up. My intention is you should be first doing that. That's the first task. When I said write your own resume, see what you are. And from there, your journey starts. Journey for anybody starts from the place where they are, not from some other place. If I need to go from here to some other part of Bangalore, I need to start from the seat where I'm sitting, not from some other area. It's as simple as that. Right. It's very important for us to understand where are we and what is it that we need to do. How can I become Vivo or Apple? You are already something. You need to understand what you are. If you try to become somebody else, then you lost in the entire game somewhere. Becoming somebody else is more of upskilling, right? You working. For example, you think, compare yourself, Shubham, with when you were, I don't know, what have you done? Have you done your engineering? Or management? Shubham, if you can switch on your mic, it's fine.
Okay, sir, I am completing my engineering
You're completing your engineering. So before engineering, I'm sure whatever you have completed your 10th for sure, right? Imagine Shubham in 10th, how he was, and Shubham in a post engineering, how he will be. That is an upgrade, isn't it? There will be different upgrades. For example, the moment you become an engineer and you know these are the skills that you have achieved, this time of preparing for interview is identifying what you are, not trying to become something else. To become something else is lifetime process where you're upskilling and you're learning. If you want to get into some kind of a position, you will start learning those skills. Those are different ways how we learn it. But when you need to crack an interview, the way you need to do is, tomorrow if the interview is there, today you should not see to upskill. You see, where are you? What are you? You need to identify these Vivo or Apple. These are all just examples. There are 1,000 different human beings. Everybody is unique. Everybody is wonderful. You need to understand what is it that you are and how can you position yourself. Everything is about how do you position. So understand it like this. For example, this hand which you are seeing, right? So this is the company and this is you. It will never match. It will not move. If this is the company and this is you, it will fix. The wheel will move. So when you don't get a job, don't get bad. Don't feel bad. Don't feel sad about it. It means that you are like this and the company is like this. You need to find a company which is like this. Then it will move. You're getting my point. We need to do little bit of connections just to ensure how do we fit in the requirement. If you see your company is like this and if you're like this, during the preparation, ensure that you also bend a little so that you fix in that. You understand? This is an analogy I'm trying to say. My intention is to prepare for the company. Yeah. Upskilling is a very different way. Okay. Now, sorry, you have a question?
Means what company wants I have to prepare?
What company? See, you have prepared already. What company wants, you have to exhibit. You have to show them that you have that. Now, when company is calling you, it means they have checked your resume. It means they already think that you can be part of them. Only thing what you do in the interview is you go there and prove it that, yes, I am right candidate for you. Right? How do we prove it is what we're going to learn a little bit more in detail, right? We will go through this. Now you are all clear in my the understanding of what interview and how am I looking at, because I'm not here to give you a bookish definition which you all know can get from anywhere. That's not the point. You need to understand it in that level.
Yes, sir.
Very
yes, sir.
Good. So whatever bookish stuff is there in me, with me or with my slide or with my communication, I will put it as JPEG files and send it to you in chats. Don't worry for that. Okay. Interview process typically goes like this. You have a preparation which you do much before. There is an information exchange, which is the interview process, the way you talk and listen and all. There is a closing process. We'll understand all this. And then there is a follow-up, and sometimes there is a making the right decision. Follow-up is basically checking back whether, you know, what happened about the candidate. And making a right decision is an important thing. Never think that it's only the company who is going to select you. You should be in a position to select the company. As much you need the company, company also needs you that much. It is just that have you both connected to a level that you can do. For example, your objectives, your career goals, which you have thought of, this company should be able to help you fulfill that. Otherwise, you will waste your time. You might get some salary, some money, but you'll waste your time. You need to be so focused to see that my career goal is matching with the company's goal, and then we are moving ahead. So these are basically things that will happen. Preparation is something that you have learned till now. Like my point of preparation when I say is understanding about the company, doing the research, we discussed about it, making your profile suitable to that, writing success stories and all that. Over today, we discuss more on information exchange, that how and what happens in the interview room. Correct? So there are series of things what can be done in preparation and things like that. Don't worry. I'm going to send this as a list to you. Okay. These are all very general and genuine, general stuff, which, you know, I have put there, like carefully examine the job description. We discussed many of these things. Okay. I'll send this in a file to you. Let me just put the right slide. Okay, can you all see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay, now before I teach you certain tricks and there, let me first quickly tell you, okay, what are the kind of types of interviews that normally happens and how do you work towards those things? Okay. So there is one kind of an interview which is called as on-campus interview. On-campus interviews are all these when you are already studying, you get campus placements, they call, and people come, right? There's a very different level of preparations over there which is required, wherein they will come in bulk, they will take. So people who have a lot of requirements, they will come and there will be like aligned 50 to 80 to 100, 120 students, and there are 4 or 5 panels, and then they try to do. This is one way of doing it. I assume none of you are looking at a campus interview, right? Is there anybody in the in our group who is looking for a campus interview? Yes, Jeremiah. Okay. You are looking for a campus interview, is it?
Yes, sir.
Okay, wonderful. I'll spend a little time over there then for you. So campus interviews are basically, lot of things are already decided for that. For example, what is the package they're going to pay you? You don't need to worry for that. Your college would have already discussed with that, and then, you know, it would have come back. What is the kind of a role? It's already sort of figured out. Over here, they see more of how are you different from anybody else? So what is a big joke happens in a campus interview is 50, 60, 70% of the people will have same kind of a resume, right? 50, I'm telling this out of experience. 50% of the people will have same career objective in life, which is, that's what I said, you know, make your own resume. That's what my observation is. Everything more or less will be same in everybody's resume. They do not really believe in the paper that they do, because colleges will push you to do something and they don't really work so much. They normally need to, they succeed in the interviews only when they strongly work on the success stories, which are different from one another. But unfortunately, this campus people don't know much about the things. Then all the experience that they can put in the campus interview is the project. And the joke that happens in the project is everybody says, I was leading the team. There are a team of 5 people, we did this project and I was doing the maximum part. And their logic is, if I say I'm doing the maximum part, then the interviewer will be happy, which is not true. An interviewer also understands, right? You need to be very clear. When you say 5 people of us are doing this particular project, it means all 5 of us are equally working. You need to say the overall project is this, but this one thing is my end-to-end responsibility, and how you have done that should be your success story. That should include. That's exactly how you would see. More or less, other points of interviews you would also cover. This is something which you would keep in mind. There is something called as virtual interviews. We will learn about this in the last class a little more, but everybody faces virtual interview, right? Say for example, the first call for you, which you get over a phone, that there is an interview, would you be interested? And then they ask you 4 or 5 questions, is actually an interview. But it is done by some entry level in the HR team. That's the reason, you know, you need to only impress them to put you over there. And we will learn in the virtual interviews in the last day how to work a little more on that. There is another kind of interview is called as one-to-one interviews. Most of your interviews will be one-on-one interviews, where there is one person asking you and one person, you who's standing there. This kind of a format is called as one-on-one interviews, right? Where you have more focus and more straight people. There is something called as panel interviews. Panel interviews, you got to be very, very careful. Right? Why careful? Because there is more than one. When you talk to one person, the other person is observing you. When you talk to the other one, the one is observing you. I have spent a lot of time in the panel interviews where I was not even asking a single question, but I would decide, I would have the maximum hand in deciding whether to select this person or not, because I am just observing. See, what you should understand here is, an interviewer understands that how much you know and how much you don't know. He's not only testing your knowledge. He's testing the way you think. He's testing the way you respond. He's testing the way you behave. He is putting you in the current team and seeing, will you gel with them? Will you learn with them? Will you grow with them? Will you support them? They are seeing all those things. So when in a panel interview, you need to be more free, like where your body language should be different. You need to look at everybody. Your eye contact has to make a difference. That smile has to be more, because one person, you know, when he's looking at something, you still have an option. But here, when there are more than one people, you always need to be, you know, attentive in everything that's happening. That's something, and the rest of the things we'll anyway learn, which is common for all. Behavioral interview and stress interview. These are the other two kind of interviews. Behavioral. So what happens? I'm sure you know, in an interview, it is not just one round. There are multiple rounds that happens. You would have first an initial round to check how you are and all, and then there is a technical round. I'm not talking a lot on the technical rounds here, because you people are all technically very good. Technical round is the subject knowledge. What all you have studied till now is what you need to say. That is more of your preparation of the subject, how well you put it, right? You will all clear the technical round if you're really done good in your studies and, you know, you're prepared for it. Behavioral interview is little tricky. Behavioral interview is, they're going to check your behavior, as simple as it is. Now, understanding behavior is not easy. Understanding technical skill is easy, because technical skill is straight answer. They'll ask you, what is A plus B whole square? You say A square plus B square plus 2AB. Then they say, okay, you know the answer. Then they go to the next one. Behavioral skill is not like that. For example, in your resume, you have put hardworking. Now they're going to ask you some different question, like, you know, how do you do this particular work during that? And there they'll check your answer, whether it is coming out as a hardworking person or not as a hardworking person. And then they will understand. Oh, that's the reason I told you, don't unnecessarily write something in your resume which you are not. You don't need to unnecessarily give them a hint. Don't think that if you write hardworking, you'll get a job. Or, you know, if you write something very nice things, they'll get a job. Whatever you write, when they find out, because the interviewer will look in your resume and ask questions, they will find that in you, then you are safe there. So don't unnecessarily overdo things, and then which you can't, you know, prove it over there or put it over there. Your preparation is the key. The well you prepared, your chances of cracking the interview is high. If you know what are they looking at, you know what skills they're looking at, if you understand what competencies they want, and what behaviors they want, accordingly, you can actually, put that. So study the JD so carefully and sit and write, okay, what are they expecting from a candidate, right? We call this as persona. What kind of a persona is basically what kind of a person they will hire. That person may, wo jo kya skills hone, whatever skills should be there, what her behavior should be there, how he or she should be dressing, how he or she should be talking. You need to just go there and show them that you are that person. That's how it is. The last one is called stress interviews. This is something which doesn't happen with most of the interviews. Like, for example, this happens with people who are at a little senior level more than at a junior level. Until and unless the interviewer is really bored and he wants to play with you, there will not be a lot of stress interview. But if you face a stress interview is basically like that. They will push you on one particular thing so that you will start behaving little odd. So most of my interviews, which they ask me in my organization to do, would be stress interviews. Stress interview is not like you prepared on any topic or something, but I know that you have prepared and you have come. You tell me a point, then I don't go to the second question. I get deeper, 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 and deeper into it. As deeper I go, people will, some point of time, I want to see where they're like, oh, enough, man. So I basically try to check there how much stress they can take. If I push them to the corner, how much they do. This typically happens in sales interviews a lot. This happens where you have a lot of people management kind of roles, where you have organization building kind of roles, because these jobs take a lot of stress. And how do you do it? It also happens in customer service roles. because you might have an angry customer. How do you manage and stuff like that? Over here, it is not about the right answer or wrong answer, but it is all about how are you listening to me? How are you taking the question? What kind of an attitudes are you putting out? Are you changing your behavior or your style in between because you have stress or you are still there? You need to keep calm for this entire thing. All you need to know is just this is 30 minutes he's trying to push. Let me be whatever. What will happen? Maximum. You would say maybe you will not be suit for the job, but you shouldn't get panic and, you know, shouldn't say something and you shouldn't blah, 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 blabber about anything. Stress interview is not like he's checking the rightness of your answer, but he's seeing your thought process and how much deeper you are able to go. Normally, when people say something which they are not, that is where they are caught. And then it's very difficult to come out of that situation. So that's why I told you from the beginning, avoid telling anything which you are not. If you are a Vivo, position yourself as a Vivo. Don't position yourself as an Apple. If you're an Apple, position yourself as an Apple. Don't position yourself as Vivo. That's the key thing over there. Fair enough. Now, understand what interviewer looks for. And that's exactly what you need to give. If I put it like this overall, interview will look, number one, is for your capability. Isn't it? He will see for your skills, your experience and your creativity. So you need to see that how will I show my capability to the interview? So your story and your answers, your everything which you're talking about should focus to him that in any point of time, you're showing that how capable you are for the role that you're doing. From the resume to the way you're talking, everything should show. The first bit is capability. The second one is credibility. Credibility is more like integrity, values. Can they rely on you? Would you be able to be a team member? Would the other members will, you know, support you? Are you going to support them? Are you all going to go together? Will you become a team supporter, team member, rather than, you know, becoming like an anti-fellow and stuff like that? Now, understanding credibility for an interviewer is also a little difficult, right? They will going to ask you so many different things. But the best part is your stories will build credibility, right? Your answers will give them, show them the capability, but your stories will build the credibility that what you're trying to say, because you have done it already and you are the hero in your story. That's how the credibility is built. The third one is confidence. As I said, if you are very clear about it, you're prepared well, confidence automatically comes. It's all about the communication skills and leadership qualities. When I say communication skills, again, I'm not talking about English. It is the way you communicate in whichever language, depending upon what role you go, what job you go. But at the same time, you need to ensure that you show up certain leadership qualities as well. Leadership qualities are like not being panic. If they say something, you are not just taking, you know, about it. Some places, sometimes they do some offensive stuff where you suddenly feel little, what is it that they're saying like that? You need to be very calm over there, right? You need to give chance for different other, if there are like group of people, then you need to give chance. Imagine two people ask questions at the same time. Right? Then suddenly what happens if in a panel interview it happens, two ask at the same time, then one stops because they have some understanding and the other one asks you, you answer it. Once you finish it, no, ask the other one, sir, you are asking me something. Suddenly that shows that, okay, this person is concerned about it. Now that's a leadership skill that comes out. You shouldn't be like, chalo, I'm saved from his question. Don't do that. If you see that somebody wants to ask something and you are saying, even when you are talking, giving an answer in between, the interviewer want to say something and you continued and he didn't ask the question. The moment you finish, ask the interviewer, sorry, sir, you are asking something. I was just explaining. So I was in that flow. Tell me, what is that you're asking? The moment you say that, it shows the leadership quality and your confidence over there. That's how you build confidence. And the fourth one is composure. Composure is basically the way you know the problem solving skills and the overall outlook. Most of your composure is in your hand, right? It is completely like how you have dressed, what tone you're carrying, and how do you stop your nervousness over there? How do you talk easily? And how do you solve problems? Now, this is a skill that you need to really work on. Problem solving skills is something which people see. Now, when I say problem solving skills, it is not always a formula based or something like that, but real life problem solving. So this is a place where I would suggest all of you to create your success story, where in your story, you are saying that how you can look at a problem and solve it. Now, because this is not a problem solving training, still I need to tell you, I will tell you one line secret of how to solve problems. If I take a training, it will be a 5-6 hours of training only on problem solving, but one line I will say. A problem can be solved when, let me give you an analogy. Imagine you are standing and a big balloon is around you, a big balloon, and you are looking at the entire balloon. How are you seeing it? That is how people see the problem. The way you should see is you need to come out of the balloon and hold the balloon in your hand, and then you can see it from all sides. Then you see the problem is very small. This is the attitude in which you should go. Now, how do you solve a problem is a problem needs to be broken down into small pieces. When you make a break a big problem into small pieces, then you will understand ki every small thing you can handle. And that's how any problem is solved. Problem lie sounds big because you are inside the bubble and you're looking at it, inside the balloon and you're looking at it. When you break it into small, you basically come out and look at it like this, and then you feel I can solve it. That's one way. So what I suggest you is when you build your stories, ensure your stories are built around these four things, especially credibility and composure, or the problem solving to be more precise. Capability will automatically come in story. Trust me, it will automatically come. And the way this entire thing happened, you will have confidence. The smartest person will sit and create a story in a way where all these four things are displayed. Right? You can always create a story where credibility, confidence, and composure are displayed. With regard to capabilities, right? It depends on what skills they are looking at it. So you need to have that little tweak in the story. But out of your three stories, right? Any story should actually talk about all these things. If you are making something individual, then you focus on the credibility, focus on the problem solving, confidence will automatically come. Right? Now, understand what are the goals of an employer and goals of an interviewee. Then you will be more clear about it. For example, your goals when you go for a job is to fully understand the job. That is what you should keep in mind. To match your skills, experience, and knowledge to the critical aspects of the job. So whatever is a JD, you need to ensure that when I am there, I need to fully understand the role and I need to show again and again, I match my skills, my experience and my knowledge to whatever the role is required. That's all what you need to do. And to demonstrate that you are a good fit. Whenever I say the word exhibit or demonstrate, these are very powerful things. Imagine you know something and you have not shown it. It is of no use of knowing something. You need to exhibit it. You need to demonstrate it. You need to show them that you are the right fit. And that is how it needs to be done. At the same time, understand what are the employer's goal. Their goals are is to assess your knowledge, skills, and abilities. See, they are not gods, or they are not coming from some other planet. You know, you will go and sit in their position in 1-2 years. That's not a problem. They would have got some clear instruction that I am looking for a candidate like this. Organization is looking for a candidate like this. This candidate should have these skills, these abilities, right? And you need to see whether they'll fit in the role or not. And another job with the job organization is what they will only see. So when they are coming to you to see that these skills which the organization wants, they have it or not, are they fit in? And you, if you have researched well, you already know what skills they are looking at it. And you also want to be fit. They also want you to be fit. Where is the problem? Why do you think anybody fails in the interviews? People fail in the interviews because they don't follow any of these things. They just mess it up. They are overconfident. I said, no, without clarity, that confidence people, I will go, I will say whatever it is, let me see. Nothing happens like that. If you really want something, you need to go like this. Think that from here, you need to go, say, for example, say Tirupati, you need to drive it in that direction. Only then you go. If you drive it in any direction, you don't go there. right? Imagine it's a running race. You are in the start point. There is an end point. You need to run in that direction, in that ring, or you know whatever they say race, that course. If you don't run like that, you want to run somewhere else, you will never win. A preparation will ensure you that you understand what is the path and go there. You will crack every interview if you have really prepared and planned to go there and crack. The problem is when you don't want to do anything and you just think that, oh, somebody told me today I did a puja, I gave a coconut and you know I put a you know tilak or maine pray kiya, you know maine whatever I have done and then I know I'll get it. That doesn't work like that, right? Your job, your cracking interview is completely, completely in your hand. Are we good till here? Are we all clear? Are we all clear? Can I get a yes or a no or yes? Okay. Just a second. Okay, one minute. Somebody just entered my room. Okay. Fair enough. Are we all good? We got yes, sir. Yes, sir. Okay. So why I'm asking, I'm giving you a little break because I've been talking so much. The next point, what I'm going to say is the most important and the most big tool I'm going to give you to crack all interviews. A trick, a strategy, how to crack it. So before me getting into the strategy, I'm giving a second break to your mind to just check that. Are you all good? Did we all understand? Anybody has any questions till now? Should I give you the trick?
No, sir.
Yes, somebody sir. Said. Somebody said no. Don't want the trick.
No, sir. No doubt.
I'm just playing them. Good. So we're all good. Now listen carefully. Yes. For next fight and. I'm sure you're all listening to this also carefully, but this is something that's going to change the way you answer it. The concept of tail answering, right? I want you all to understand very clearly about this. If you have questions, you can ask me today, tomorrow, whenever we are connected. But you need to understand and learn this very well. This is like a wonderful tool which will help you to get what it is. Let me explain you what is tail answering. See, interviewers will ask different questions to you. Now, when I say an interviewer game plan, you have a choice that the entire interview is managed by you or by the interviewer. Anyone takes the lead and they normally do. Hold the entire conversation, right? Because you're there to give an interview and meaning of tail. I'll tell you, I'm trying to explain that, but I have a way of bringing the concept so that you will never forget it. Balloon jaisa ya fir wo mobile jaisa. I'll explain you in a while. So basically tail ka matlab pooch hota hai. I just coined it like that. Tail is wo jo billi ke piche hota hai na, wo. That's the tail. So interviewer, when other things are all set and in place, and when you ask, they're asking you the questions, they, as I told you, they're also searching in your resume what questions to be asked. And I already suggested you that you make your resume like a question paper, not like an answer sheet, that when they see it, they start getting a question. Now, the tail answering concept is all about even you answer it like that. Okay? Even you answer it like that. For example, somebody asks you, what is your favorite subject? You will say your favorite subject. Say, for example, somebody asks me, what is my favorite subject? I would say economics. This is normally answering. Okay? Or I would say economics because I studied it and I understand the concepts and I really like how it really works. It's one way of answering. But tail answering is like this. Economics is my favorite subject because it talks about money, it talks about economy. And the best part of economics, which I like, is the microeconomics. And I stop. you know what is the next question that the interviewer will ask? Can anybody tell me what do you think would be the next question they will
ask? Tell me something about microeconomics. What have you understood?
Very good. Now, I have prepared very well about the microeconomics. Got it? So it goes like this. I told you earlier also. Everything that you answer, you will get plus points. If something you are not able to answer, you get a little minus point. And that's basically how your meter goes. Now, how about giving them the question that you have already prepared about it? You got it? So every answer you try to give, prepare it. It comes with some practice. It will not just like that come. But tell them something. In the end, leave a point which they will hold. And they will feel, oh, I'm very smart. I'm going to hold them here. And I will ask, okay, what is microeconomics? I'll say microeconomics talks about, you know, the minute features of the economic conditions of India, where this happens. But I enjoyed very much when I actually worked on, the microfinancing projects that I have done. And I stop. What do you think would be the next question they'll ask? What do you think will be the next question they'll ask?
What is microfinance?
What microfinance projects you have done, or what is microfinance? Ask me. I have prepared about it. Now I will tell you my success story of how we have done microfinancing. And then I go on. Did you understand? How many of you have understand the concept? Say yes. If anybody wants me to explain it more detail, I will.
Yes, sir.
You all understood? Very good. All are smart people I have over here. Okay. Now, listen to this carefully. How easily you have understood, it is not that easy to implement. You need to work. You need to practice for it. You need to prepare for it. You are able to understand it the moment I explained you, because I'll take a little credit for myself. This is effective communication, what I was talking about. I tried to put it to you in a way that you will get it quickly. But doing that with your own subject, with your people, is not that easy. At the same time, it is not very difficult also. You just need to have that little clarity and confidence to try it in that way. Okay? Now, slowly down the line, when you start preparing, that's the reason I told you the first important task is your resume writing. You sit and you write. Your half or 80% of your preparation for an interview is done when you do that, because you know everything that what you can talk about it. That automatically gives them something. The rest place where it needs to work out is something which we will talk tomorrow about, handling questions, tough questions, easy questions, simple questions, and all those things we'll anyway talk tomorrow, isn't it? What you need to understand here is, how do I answer it in a way that the next question the interviewer asks, which I want them to ask? Maybe one or two times it wouldn't work. That's okay. The next question, whatever they ask, give them an answer in a way where it goes to the next one. Because you can't just keep the same direction in all the way. As I told you again and again, every correct answer you give, every answer, when I say correct, it is not about correct by formula, but correct by the way they understand, okay, this is falling in the right place and they're happy about the answer. I think that's how the better way to put it is, they're happy about your answer. Your score goes up, right? As many questions they ask, that many things. So you need to do it. Just not like every question you keep a tail and don't think that in one tail the entire interview goes. No. Don't do that. A question comes, answer them, and say next one or two questions they ask is what you want them to ask. Because you have prepared with 3, 4, 5 success stories, you need an opportunity to talk. And success stories, as I told you many times, are your personal stories. They will not get bored. They'll get engaged with that. If you say something about generic stuff, which other candidates would also have told, they might feel a little bored. So people always want conversation to be happening in that way. Now, that is the key. Tail answering. The way you need to answer is, your answer in the end should leave them a question in their mind to ask. Like how you made a resume, which is a question paper, they look at it and they ask you, your answers to a level should also be in that way, that they look at it and then they get what can be the next question that they can ask. And as many times as you can do that, just not the same tail, you don't catch it, couple of answers, then you go to the next one, right? Your intention, your objective is don't give them a question for which you have not prepared the answer. Okay, that will also bounce back to you. You know, it's a two-sided sword if you don't prepare very well. So it's all about preparation, and give them the question that you really want them to ask. Right? Like people talk about the project. Now you say project, I have done this. Maybe you've done a small bit. That's okay. They don't see if you say I leaded the project. It is not that they're going to make you a manager there. They're still seeing how much you contributed honestly for that. So it's okay. I did a very, very small thing, but I really understand. I really learned there. You know, understanding a concept is really difficult. I was almost a failure there. If I tell in an interview, what do you think the next question would be? Oh, you think you're almost a failure. What happened? Please ask. That's my success story. How that failure I almost felt, but I was successful. And that's your story that you have written. Yeah, I didn't know about this. I have learned about it. I've spent time. I have actually worked day and night to study all these things. And I spoke to different people. I asked different people to suggest me. Each of these lines will give them ideas of, oh, this person is not just going to give up if he doesn't know. He will go to 10 people and understand and do it. Such a positive thing for them to give you a job. Clear? Are you all understanding me? Are you all with me? Is the concept very clear? Say yes.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Right. The next small piece is basically about dressing etiquettes for your interview. You need to understand why are why you're dressing for interview is basically to create that impression. It's important. You might feel that, oh, I don't normally do like this. This role is like that. No. First impression makes a lot of difference. Imagine you have not dressed very properly and you know you have little torn clothes and you're trying to go to a 5-star hotel. They would not even open the door. Maybe you have a lot of money in your pocket. Who cares? The look creates something. Now understand this carefully. In first 10 seconds of somebody's interaction with somebody, they create an impression about you. Okay? And from there, the conversation goes. For example, they saw you in first 10 seconds. So think it like this. Before interview, you are at 0. When you get a job, you are at 100. This is the scale, right? Think it like that. Before interview, scale is at 0. When you get a job, scale is at 100. Now, first 10 seconds, they create an impression. For example, you created a wonderful impression and you got 20. And your answers will start scoring from there, 21, 22, 30, 40, 50, 60. You know, your chances of winning is high. Imagine you have not scored anything. Your score is 0. Then you start from 0 to 1, 2, 3. You know, you need more work. And if you really dress bad, it will be minus 10. It's more dangerous. So it is important, the first impression that you make, you score some points that, oh, this candidate is good. And it's easier for you. You build on that. You build on those and then you make, right? So you dress for your interview for creating that impression, which is the most important. The confidence for you to talk will come when you are there in that. It also shows a kind of personality you are, right? Which people would want to observe from you and see it. Give them a good thing. Why do you need to do that? This is the easiest thing in the campus interviews because everybody will be in uniform. But when you dress it for your own interview, it depends on what are your combinations of your shirt and pant? If you need to use a tie, you use. How do you put a knot? What's the size of knot? Oh, if I can get in detail, I can tell you 1,000 things that people can look at it and observe and see the professionalism over there. And then the rapport. Rapport is like how closely they can interact with you depending upon this. Imagine you're coming and your hands are sweating and your face is sweating. Little body odor is coming. Nobody wants to come talk to you nearby. And then they'll be like, okay, already you are at the minus. You might be running. You might be going there in a hurry, but don't hurry to get into the interview. Wait for a while. Clean yourself. Use a deo. Don't overdo it. And then go with that pleasant personality to them where you already score the first 20 from the 0. And the next, I have taught you enough and more tricks to go from there to the 100.
So,
right? Yeah.
So formals is a good dress to an interview.
Yes. See, formals is a good dress. Everybody understand, but there is little more detail to the formal. A few things I will tell you. Full sleeves.
Yes.
With a button knot is important. The color of the shirt, try to keep it lighter, right? I say light blue, sky blue or white is a very good stuff. Pant, no jeans. You need to have either a dark pant or you can also use a khaki kind of a pant with white where people look very, very smart. Tie has to be a very different color than the shirt and the pant. And, you know, if at all you're using a blazer, then that's a very different thing. Your shoe. Shubham, can you just mute your mic? Yeah. Your shoe and your belt color should match. You can't have a black shoe and a brown belt or a brown a shoe and a black belt. This is something not there. The way your buckle is there, like for example, if this is the line for the shirt button, your buckle should stick there. These are all very, so much if people would really observe, they say, but all these are in detail of formals. Just let's not take it out by saying formals. Formals, can there be a lot of stuff is there. When it comes to women, they need to understand the jewelries and certain other things, you know, don't carry coins in your pocket when you go for interview. That coins or keys, you know, that chal, it's a disturbance. You would not even know it's a disturbance for you in your flow, for them. Don't keep your phone in vibrator mode. In that half an hour, if nobody talks to you or you don't talk to anybody, trust me, India is not going to stop. In fact, you can get your job. So don't be so that I'll keep it in silent or sometimes people take phone. It's very, very wrong and irritating and stuff like that. Don't keep it in silent. Switch off for that time. You will be much peaceful to do that. Because sometimes I see people put it in silent and the light of the phone comes so bright that, you know, it can be seen from the pocket. Don't do all such things, right? I have a list of things, dressing etiquettes. You can go through. I can send these as your screenshots also if you want. But all clothes should be neatly ironed. Clean and well-groomed hairstyle, wear clean, polished, conservative shoes, clean and trimmed fingernails. Fingernails are important, okay? Always trim it. Otherwise, you'll have dust falling there and it kills the entire impression. Fingernails, full trim. For a woman, maybe they can put a light nail polish, not that bright reds and stuff like that. Empty pocket, no noisy coins, and a smile always, always should be on there. Something which you should not do is do not wear clothes that are chaotic patterns. Chaotic patterns are not matching patterns. That's what I'm saying. Even if when you say formals, if it is not matching to your shirt and pant, it doesn't make sense. Do not wear jeans. Do not wear any earrings. If boys have certain earrings and all, avoid in the interviews to take them off for that particular time and, you know, do there. If for women and all, don't put a longer ones, a small top is big enough and good enough. Do not overdo your usage of cologne. Don't spray too much that the moment you go, suddenly they find a different smell. Your objective of using a perfume is not to give your smell to them, but you should not have a bad smell. If you don't need to give a good smell, neither a bad smell. Just to keep it orderless is what I'm trying to say. Do not wear anything uncomfortable, like maybe, you know, a bracelet which starts falling here and there, or maybe some people would have a long big earring which might be disturbing. Do not unnecessarily wear anything uncomfortable. Fair enough. Then there are few quick tips for interviews. Arrive always 10 minutes early. These are all general gyan. I'm sure everybody would have got this. You just need to follow it. You people can read it from the screen. It's pretty simple. Any questions you have, you can ask me. All these things anyway, I will send you in the screenshots. Right, switch off your mobile. Do not speak negatively. We learned the positive communication yesterday. Keep an attitude which is positive. And if you do not get a job, don't worry. It is just the match didn't happen. You would get it. But you have really prepared to a level to get and crack what you really want to crack it. You will get it. That is not at all a problem. Right, that's the end of the day for me. You people have any questions, you can ask me. I will be more than happy to answer you on this.
Sir, I'm Jeremiah.
Jeremiah, yes, tell me, Jeremiah.
So I have a recent internship experience, like during my PG course. So the thing I just want to ask is, like, as if you are an the interviewer and you are asking me about my internship experience. So right now you are asking me like what work I have done or the learnings I got from there.
The learning, my intention is to know learnings you got. But if I ask you learnings, you will tell me straight four things which I will not have a way to assess it or judge it. So I will ask you, what have you done? And then I will ask you, what have you learned? And then I'll ask you, what kind of problems did you face and how did you come? So why I'm doing all these things, because I want to find out few things from you that have you spent time learning something or you have done only what you know. Okay. I also need to find out that have you come across some challenging things and you won it, or you it was like there are different people and you just been part of it and finished it. That's why I would do that. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Anybody else has any other questions?
Sir, my name is Arvind, sir.
Arvind, tell me.
Sir, actually, I have one doubt, sir.
Yeah.
Apart from writing in resume, apart from writing leadership skill, a good communication skill, what are the skills can I add in my resume, sir, which should be different from others?
What skills do you have? First, find that out. If you just write something, they will going to check it with you. Otherwise, there are 110 skills that can be done. For example, when I put in my resume skills, I put it as negotiating skills. When I put a negotiating skills, they're going to ask me on that. And I have a story. I have content to talk about it. So if I give you a list, I can give you 100 skills that can be written there. Right. You can put emotional intelligence to, you can put team motivation to, you can put leadership to, coaching skills to, training skills to, a number of things you can put. But that's not how it is. You need to see what is it that you think skills that are there with you, because this is what they're going to ask you. See, Arvind, it's like this. If you tell me you have leadership skill and in the interview, if I find that you don't have leadership skills, you will be rejected. If you have not told that you have leadership skills and in the interview, I find you don't have leadership skill, then you will not be rejected. I will say that, okay, good. He at least knows what he or she doesn't know. So don't worry and don't see that others have written something. I will write something which others have not seen. Don't worry about all that. Don't do all that thing. Spend time to see what are your real skills. That is what that SWOT analysis, which I explained to you yesterday, is all about. Spend time to understand what are your real skills, and that should come. And when you put those skills, it can be very specific, but you have something to talk to make them understand and impress. Like morning, somebody asked me sometime back, they know how to understand, to find the roots and all. If that is a skill, you put that and somebody will definitely ask you a question on that, and your success story should be there, or your story should be there to talk about it. So find what are your real skills and then only put them. Okay.
Okay, sir, thank you.
Yep. Anybody else?
Yes, sir. Balu, sir.
Yes, Balu, tell me.
How to improve my communication skills or how to develop my communication skills?
Improving communication skills is a very big and long thing for me. It's not a small trick that I should say. But see, improving communication skills is a process. It is not a one activity or one day thing. But it is not that somebody can't do. You have to do it continuously. There are a few simple tricks I can say what people should start doing. One, the language. First, you need to have a little higher grip. I'm assuming that, Balu, with your experience, what you have, I'm trying to put it in that context. Okay. Try to build a little more on the language. Reading papers of, say English if you want to improve, reading English papers, watching English movies, communicating in English. There is no other way to learn English more than using it in your daily way. That is number one. Number two is making it effective. The language becomes effective when you learn the art of using less words and communicating more. That is when slowly you will work towards being effective. To explain something, just try it. To explain something, if you are using, say, 250 words, try to explain the same thing in 100 words. You will start becoming slowly more and more effective. You need to work for that. You need to do one by one small things. people who want to improve their language and all, they should read something very loudly. So what happens is there is a connection between the sound, the way you pronounce it, and the way your ear listen to it. If that connection is set well, you would know how to pronounce the word properly and talk to them. The second level, when I talk about improving communication with regard to a particular way, for example, with my team, how do you increase? This is more of lot more of behavioral skills required with communication. See, God has given you 2 ears and 1 mouth to listen double and speak half. You see how the communication becomes effective. The problem comes because we don't want to listen to somebody, we want to say. Knowingly or unknowingly is a trouble. Even if when you are with your team, you are a team leader, you have 20 people working under you, still you have 2 ears and 1 mouth. Listen to them double and speak half of it. Whatever you communicate will be effective. That's slowly how you should work. And there are so many other big and small ways to do it, but that's a process which will continue doing it. Right, sir? Wonderful. Okay, it's already 7:16. Good, guys. So let's catch up tomorrow. Try to be on time. Let's not waste any time. Tomorrow we are going to do questions. So what I ask everybody of you is, I'm not going to have a slide tomorrow. Okay, what I want you all is, I want you all to come with questions that you think which are either common or which are difficult to answer. Because giving you some gyan, what I have or what I can get from internet, I'm sure you also can get it and 1,000 other people will give you. What I will add value is, come with your straight questions. What do you think, how I should handle this? Like I promised, Rasik, yes. That I'm going to start it with tomorrow with his question on how do you, tell me something about yourself. So you all, I want you all to come with questions. As many questions you come, I will directly tell you how those things can be done, and that's how the content going to be tomorrow. Right? Thank you very much, guys. I hope I'm adding value in your life. Your time is utilized. If you really like what I'm saying, I'm happy. You can say yes to me, which will make me.
Yes, sir. Sure.
Good.
Yes, sir.
Can I ask one question?
Yes. Ask Jarmia.
Sir, I think we sit in a campus placement. So we'll get to land in some sort of role which is not the experience that I have or the what they are looking like in the resume, they won't find.
Right.
So in that situation, if suppose I don't have an experience in sales, so here the company comes and tells that we came here to recruit for sales profile. So in that situation, how I need to make a story telling that I have been in college, we have a tech fest, which used to happen every year. So I used to manage the marketing part of the tech fest. So how I need to build a story in this particular situation?
So you got to understand the role requirements. For example, here what I understand is they're more into sales. Sales requires meeting new people and not being scared or afraid about rejections. Salespeople face the maximum rejections, but the skill, when I teach sales skills to people, what I tell them is when somebody bangs a door on you, you should still have a smiling face for the next door when you knock, because that's a new door.
Okay.
Now your first experience where you will bring in saying that, for example, I have worked on collecting funds, donations, contributions. Then I have moved to 100 different people and 95% of them has banged door on me. But the last 5% from where I collected money were able to do that entire fest, kind of a story will give me that you are the one who are not going to take the rejections just like that, but you'll work towards it to ensure you can be successful.
Okay.
That's how I would have taken the story.
Okay, sir.
Right. Okay, people. Thank you very much. Catch you tomorrow.